Penguin Random House Audio presents A Cigarette Lit Backwards. This is the author, Tea Hacic-Vlahovic. For Stefano. In loving memory of Giancarlo Di Trapano and Joshua Parsons. Hello, world, I'm your wild girl, The Runaways. Dexter's Lab. Everyone knows Iggy Pop and the Stooges lived in the funhouse, right? Even Nico stayed there, cooked badly, and gave Iggy an STD. The place was legendary, and our scene had the same thing. Dexter's Lab was our funhouse, a spot between Carbro Elementary and the train tracks. Fridays after school, I'd take the bus downtown and walk 20 minutes to get there. I wasn't allowed at Dexter's on school nights. "Sup, cat?" Dexter loomed in the doorway. "Sup, Dexter?" I squeezed past him, holding my breath. Dexter stalked me down the hall, and his stink followed. In spite of his stench, he was lethally hot. Or because of it. I only held my breath to spare myself from his powers. Dexter's B.O. was a fatally poisonous aroma. His sweat, a seductive secretion that caught girls like bugs in a Venus flytrap. Deadly Dexter. His grin was feral and snaggletoothed and mauled everyone he saw. A smile from Dexter was a punch in the gut with brass knuckles. His exquisitely greasy hair could oil 1,000 cast iron skillets. I barely resisted grabbing it as I gazed up at him. He towered over me at 6 feet. His body was frail and his complexion ghostly. He wore the same outfit each day. Like a cartoon character, he had a uniform. Crusty blue jeans with tapered calves and tears in the knees. Ratty British flag sweater held together with safety pins. Silver pyramid belt and steel-toed combat boots. To top it off, a work of art. His classic black leather biker jacket was painted, patched, studded, and spiked to perfection. It held so many trinkets, I couldn't count them if I tried. They were meticulously placed and so beautifully arranged, I was astounded he did it himself. But I wouldn't dare question it. In our scene, boys embellished their own threads. DIY fashion was honorable. Sewing was masculine. Chances were Dexter didn't change his underwear either. Only Ashley saw Dexter's underwear. She was his girlfriend, and I hated her for that. She was the prettiest punk in our scene, and probably the whole country. She could have been on America's Next Top Model. I told her that once, and she said, "Reality TV is for sellouts." Ashley was nearly as tall as Dexter. Her limbs were long and lean, and she flailed them around when she talked. And she talked all the time. Ashley always had something cool, funny, or loud to say. Everyone listened. Ashley took up space and demanded attention. We were all stuck on her. Ashley's hair was fire red and spiked. She had two things most teens didn't: body ink and face metal. The cherry on her shoulder was an homage to Cherie Curry. A silver ring squeezed her bottom lip, accenting its plumpness. There was something obscene about it, like her mouth was a glazed Krispy Kreme donut pumped full of strawberry jam. Her face was a Southern Gothic masterpiece, with swamp green eyes and sky-high cheekbones. All her outfits were sick. Nylon pants, fur coats, sequin tops, latex boots, heart-shaped glasses. Nobody knew where she shopped. She didn't like me, but she didn't fight me. She barely acknowledged me, actually. She knew I didn't steal people's boyfriends. I stomped over smashed beer cans, slimy pizza boxes, and crumpled cigarette packs on the way to the fridge door. How'd he do it? Nature's meth. Teenage rage. Dexter replaced a regular door with a refrigerator door. So there was a refrigerator door in the middle of the hallway. When you opened it up, you didn't see the inside of a fridge. You'd see the party room. The fridge was smaller than a regular door, so you had to duck to go inside. The door was elevated, so you had to jump into the room. Alice in Wonderland meets Train Spotting. Because of this ducking and jumping, not even the coolest person could make a smooth entrance into the party room. Some tried, but it was impossible. I liked this because I was the least cool person in our group. The fridge gave everyone a bad shot. I followed Dexter inside, trying not to stare at his butt crack, which always peeked out of his pants. It winked at me, and I blushed. Guys, Kat. Dexter introduced me to grown-ups sprinkled around the party room. Kat, guys. You can be a grown-up without being an adult. Being an adult means you have an adult life. These were just kids who grew up physically, but were still like us inside. I nodded at the trailer park dealers, and they nodded back. When everyone was done nodding, I found a relatively clean spot on the carpet to sit down on. I crossed my legs and pulled my coat over my outfit. I hated my clothes. I shopped at the PTA thrift store. Used tennis skirts, worn men's jeans, and yellowed wife beaters made up my wardrobe. Plus, precious shirts I copped at concerts. I had a casualties shirt, an anti-flag shirt, a bouncing souls shirt, and a Blink-182 shirt I couldn't wear anymore because when I did, my friends called me a poser. When that happened, I had to wear my shirt inside out. My favorite jeans were too big for me, so I closed them with a safety pin. One day the pants were on my floor, and the safety pin was left open, and I was reaching over my bed to turn over my specials record, and I tripped and stepped straight onto the needle. It went through my foot, and I had to get a tetanus shot. Dexter's lab was always full. Kids came from Chapel Hill High, old public school, East Chapel Hill High, new public school, Carolina Friends, private school for hippies and reluctant children of hippies, and Village Charter, sketchy strip mall institution for pregnant teens and fuck-ups. A couple of kids were dropouts, like Dexter. He was 18 when I met him, but by then he'd already lived alone. There were rumors, of course, like he emancipated himself from his abusive parents and hustled for a living. Or he was orphaned and tossed between foster homes until he ran away and squatted in an abandoned building, which became his lab. The most believable theory was that his grandma raised him and Dexter inherited her place when she died. The worst rumor, told by the worst people, was that he killed his parents to turn their home into a party palace. Their bodies are still hidden somewhere. I couldn't believe anyone would joke about that. Dexter was sweet, and I knew a hint others didn't. Months ago, I'd gone into Dexter's bedroom to leave my coat on his bed. But the bed was full of other people's coats, and I was worried something would happen to my coat, since it was my dad's. So I thought I'd hang it in Dexter's closet. In his closet, I saw a uniform, similar to what Dad wore to work. It was hanging there, in his size, with his smell. So he must work at a garage. He fixed cars or bikes. Otherwise, he was a plumber or handyman. All those uniforms look alike. Anyway, I figured when all of us went to school or wherever, Dexter went to work. He didn't talk about it because I guess he didn't want to spoil our fun. Nobody likes crushing a rumor. Sometimes a little kid from Colberth Middle School hung out. He was a miniature rude boy. We called him Little Tim. He was only 12, but freakishly tough. Nobody messed with him. The boys would say, "He's a baby. I'll smack him when he's in high school." The truth was, even the rowdiest guys were afraid of him. He was like that Chucky doll, tiny and terrifying. Sometimes deadbeat grown-ups dropped in to sell weed or booze. They'd usually only hang out long enough to make out with some punk girl. They didn't try with me. I guess I looked younger than 16. I wasn't allowed to dye my hair or get piercings. My boobs weren't in yet. My haircut was the same home-cut bob I'd had as a kid. The color? Forgettable. My scalp didn't have the balls to produce a strong saturation. "Is there beer?" I asked Dexter. "PBR," he pointed to the kitchen. "Get me one," barked Little Tim. I crawled to the fridge door and hopped into the hallway. Then I headed to the real refrigerator. Aside from booze, the fridge offered a jar of pickles, a few bottles of hot sauce, and an oily bag of biscuits from Sunrise Biscuit Kitchen. That was Dexter's favorite food. He revealed this to me once during a rare moment alone with him. I was honored to learn a secret about him, or even a widely known fact, so long as he told me privately. That night, he held a biscuit out toward me. "I get extra for mooches." "No thanks. You anorexic or racist?" "I prefer grilled cheese. It's my favorite."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.